case where you, when you start getting into the word and you just try to start preparing, and it's like so much just starts flooding in, and it's like, God, what is it? Which is it? And it's like, you know, making sure that you don't take what you want to necessarily put forward, but what God would have for you to bring forward. And
yes.
I'd say the last week or so has just been that struggle and trying to figure out, kind of, you know, hearing from Him and getting to that point. But, again, I want to thank God, thank Pastor, your honor to everyone here in the respective places. And this morning, and if you would follow along with me, we're going to be coming from 1 John, chapter 1. And we're going to be coming and reading from verses 1 through 10. 1 John, 1 John, first chapter, verses 1 through 10. And this morning I'm going to be reading from the NASB version.
Yes.
And if you have that, I just ask that you just follow along, read along.
Bless God. Oh, God.
First John chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. What was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. And the life was manifested, and we have seen and testified and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us. What we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. These things we write so that our joy may be made complete. This is the message we heard from Him and announced to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He Himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus His Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. You may be seated at this time. This morning, the subject of the message is, the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
And I remember, I was maybe a bit different than many. I was raised up as a young person in the church. I literally was in the church at the age of 6 and pretty much throughout. So you would hear a lot of different sayings, and as you came up, you maybe thought you had an understanding as to what some of those things meant.
Mm-hmm.
And it was more, not necessarily so much that someone directly taught you, but you just kind of pick things up along the way. And, you know, as I continue to get older and get mature and actually get in the Word for myself, as an adult, I get a better understanding of it. And I would say even now, getting into and preparing for this message, I have even a better understanding of what that statement actually and truly means, and where its foundation kind of comes around. And what I like to do is kind of take these verses that I read and kind of break it down,
mm-hmm.
and from beginning to end, because it flows all together.
Yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't jump around at all.
Mm-hmm.
And the verse that you read, it ties right in what preceded it. So
yes.
What I like to do is start off with the first first word, it's talking about the beginning and what we've heard. So here, this is being written by the Apostle John, you know, and he's talking about the beginning God, in the beginning of creation, going back to Genesis, and he's talking about what he has seen as an apostle and those that were with him, what they've seen with their own eyes and what they've looked at and the fact that they've touched with their own hands and who they're talking about is Jesus. And then him being the word of life. So they're speaking from a firsthand perspective, not some vision, not some ghost, but literally walking with God in the form of Jesus and being able to touch him and being with him, spending time with him. And then in the second verse, it says that the life was manifested, and we've seen and testified, proclaiming you the eternal life, which was the Father, and manifested to us. So it is the presence of God, his being, you know, manifesting and showing in the physical form, but yet always understanding and not getting it twisted, but still being God.
Yes.
And what we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, so that you may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write so that our joy may be made complete. Here is the message we've heard from him announced to you, that God is light and that there is no darkness at all. So before we get into that, I'd like to kind of get into maybe a bit of definitions just to make sure that we understand where we're coming from. Over the last several months, we've had a lot of discussion, and whether it's in Bible study or things that have come forth from the pulpit around relationship. Mm-hmm. And if I remember correctly, even a couple of months ago, that was one of the key points in the message that I had. Mm-hmm. And as I continue to delve deeper into it a bit more, I'd like to define relationship in terms of maybe how it's used, you know, from an English perspective, as well as how it's used in the Bible. And one of the definition I have here is relationship, the way two or more concepts, objects, or people are connected. Relationship, when we think about relationship, we think of, you know, our children, you know, our spouses, our husband, wife, and that's kind of in the natural. In the spirit, and when you think about how do we come into relationship with the Lord, we do that through salvation. So, you know, confessing our sins and accepting the Lord is our Savior. John 3:5, chapter 3, verse 5 reads, and this is where Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus. It writes, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." And this is that spiritual birth is the actual relationship. So that's us being connected with the Father is through salvation. And that's how that occurs. But sometimes there's a tendency, and I've done it, to make that into something maybe a bit more than what it actually is in its truest sense. So for an example, you can have a husband and a wife be under the same roof, and they can be connected, i.e. they're married, and they, before God, they became one, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're in fellowship with one another, right? So that takes us to, what is fellowship? So the definition of fellowship, English, is to couple with, to join together, communion. In the Greek, the word is koneia, which means association, community, joint participation and intimacy. So when you think about fellowship, and it's not, you know, there's many ways of looking at that, right? So fellowship is a group coming together for a common purpose, sharing the same resources and bound by the same responsibility. Okay. Remember these definitions. Okay. Fellowship is a group coming together for a common purpose, sharing the same resources and bound by the same responsibilities. They go through difficult trials. They suffer great peril and celebrate joyous victories as they journey along toward accomplishing their goal. Through this effective process, they are quickly bonded together, which causes deep love, commitment, and care to grow for one another. Okay, so fellowship, relationship. So we're gonna talk further about who's the audience with that? So